Thank you very much. Thanks a lot to Apex for the support and the opportunity to present here, to be honest. Yeah, I'm here to present our own executor, our lock-free executor for Rust 2. It's based on the ring buffer. That's why we name it like this. It is based on our software. So first I will introduce shortly our main product, Clepsydra SDK, which is the base of the executor. And then I will move into present how did we implement the executor itself. So we do lock-free programming. I imagine most of you are familiar with lock-free programming, but just as a very tiny explanation, lock-free programming is the more higher level name of atomic operations in the processor. In particular, the so-called compare and swap or CAS operation was invented back in the 70s, but it didn't really become popular until the early 90s, when it was started to be implemented in more higher level language. And then it really took off when Java took it on in the early 2010s. So what is the lock-free programming? Basically refers to, instead of doing locks in order to write data in memories, you use like a VC loop, just in a very short way, until you manage to put the data in a consistent state. This is what is compare and swap, because you compare the result of setting the data until you have a consistent value, and then you say, okay, I'm done. So in a manner, lock-free programming is substantially more granular than a standard locking operations, because it's just specific to one small piece of memory, as opposed to locking, which usually comes with a bigger block of code that it has to be synchronized. So in terms of exactly what I mentioned, how it works, on one hand, we have the traditional lock systems where you have a thread, locks a resource, and then free it, and then another thread can take it, etc. It's not so deterministic, as it has been discussed today, due to especially the cost of the context switch and other things. Well, the compare and swap, which is more granular, is usually depicted as a plane trying to land in a busy airport, because it tries, and if the runway is busy, then it tries again. This is how it works. It's substantially more efficient. The problem with the lock-free, as many of you may know, is that it's quite cumbersome to program with. But once you get a grasp of it, and you can build substantially advanced algorithms, you can get a massive boost in your performance. So this is what we did at Clepsydra. We have our own ring buffer. We wrap it into what we call the Clepsydra SDK. Just another library that you install in the operating system that receives data from multiple sources. It's basically a memory queue, a memory sharing system. It's somehow an executor without being called an executor. Just put here a small example that we have been tested in this computer. It's a single core computer, but still with this kind of techniques, you can substantially improve the performance. And in our ring buffer, we have two main approaches to data processing. So it's just one ring buffer, but we enable it for two different things. On one hand, we have what we call the sensor multiplexer. It's one of our two APIs. In this case, the sensor multiplexer use the ring buffer to multiplex data. So you have one producer of data, usually large volumes, like a camera or a LiDAR, and you have more than one consumer. The advantage of our lock-free ring buffer in this case is that each consumer can process data at different rates, completely independent of each other, can be completed arbitrarily as well. And the sensor multiplexer ensures that the data remain consistent. So the consumer has access to the same data while it's using it. And once the data is finished, it's just released back to the ring buffer and so on. Then we have the other approach, which is more or less the opposite, which is the event loop, in which case we have multiple producers of data. Again, they can be producing data at different rates, completely independent of each other. And in this case, the ring buffer somehow streamline all this data and put it into the single consumer, a single threaded consumer. The main advantage of these two approaches is that this ring buffer is very low power consuming, doesn't require a lot of CPU first. And the second advantage is the large throughput that they can achieve. This type of approach can achieve a substantial increase in throughput and reduction in CPU. So we say, okay, this is our main solution. Let's see what happens if we can build an executor based on this. So our first log-free executor for ROS2 is based on the event loop. In that case, what we are doing is every ROS2 publisher or advertiser is connected to one of our producers. The timers as well are what we call the schedulers in the event loop. You have seen things like Node.js as a language. They have this event emitter, but you also can schedule things. So it's, our event loop follow a similar design pattern, although completely different implementation. So you can have as many publishers as you need, as many timers as you need. The important thing is this will be associated with consumers. Each of them has its corresponding topic name consumer, one or many. But the important thing is all these things are happening in one thread. So the timers, the subscription, everything is single threaded. So you don't need to put any logs or anything there. It will just run fluently throughout. So how is this being implemented internally? We have a very similar implementation to the static single threaded executor because obviously our event loop is also single threaded. Like I said, all the subscription timers are run in the same thread. So you just schedule a housekeeping task, and at the same time, a LiDAR data is arriving. You don't need to worry about this. It will be streamlined and processed in the correct order. Publishers, of course, can run in any thread. Producers can be connected to the sensors or any other mechanism. It will be just streamlined internally by our solution. In terms of more specific implementation details, Clepsydra treats all these messages as listeners, to our event loop. So different subscriptions to the same topic, maybe just different listeners into the same, our internal subscriber. You can see some of this in our open source version of Clepsydra SDK. Timers, like I said, are also treated as a event loop event. Timer has a function, and what we do is basically stuff the function into the event loop as another in another slot, like any other event going on, whatever data or function, they can be placed into the event loop. And similarly to the static single threaded, there is no cloning. So we take the data from the different sources, may that be the DDS, the memory communications, et cetera. We treat the data exactly the same way as the single threaded does. So with this implementation, we looked as well into some of the issues in ROS at the moment. So and how our event loop executor can fix them. In particular, we look at two bugs that were raised by us to us by email conversation with Apex AI as well. One of them is the high CPU use of the executor. This is an open issue that says that when large volumes of data or high frequency data is being placed into the ROS executor, the CPU grows very fast. The second issue that we also look into it is the large point cloud pops up is unstable when there are many subscribers. So in this case, we have one producer of data publishing data to the executor with many subscribers. And in this case, there are also CPU issues and also message drops, substantial message drops. So we tested this. So we tested in a Raspberry Pi 4, the first issue that I mentioned. So we basically put a number of publishers and subscribers and start publishing at different rates. And yeah, so these are the results we got. The charts that I'm presenting are four charts for different combination of the of publishers and subscribers. So in this, when I say one subscriber means 10 publishers and with one subscriber each. We also tested with multiple subscriber each, but maybe we'll discuss this in a second when talk about the reference system. In this case, we're displaying in the chart the CPU consumption versus the throughput. So how much messages are processed, not published, but actually processed by the subscribers, and how much CPU they need. And we compare the static single-threaded, the multi-threaded executor, and Clepsydra. And as you can see here in the Raspberry Pi, the results show similar results to what we see when we run the SDK. We have substantially less CPU consumption in a standard case. This is where we already started to see. And as we grow in number of publishers and we grow in data rates, we keep seeing this more and more until a point where we started to see as well that the other executors are dropping some messages and we managed to process them all. This is what we are seeing with our executor, which, like I said, has the same features as our event loop. So low CPU consumption and large throughput. So then we have the case of the multiple subscribers. Then the results were even better. This is related to the second issue I mentioned, to have many subscribers connected to publishers. And we start to see similar results. So Clepsydra is substantially our executor. The log-free executor can process substantially more volume of data, initially with lower CPU, but as we grow, obviously, processing number of messages, the CPU grows as well. So then we tested this, we haven't done full test with the reference system. We have some elements to review there. With Galactic, we have some issues in the compilation, et cetera. But what we did manage to check was the latency. And we also see that for low volumes of data, our latency here is quite low. It's happened the same as with the CPU. We saw, I don't have more results to present, but when studying the results in extremis these last few hours, we saw that while other executors may be dropping messages and therefore remaining with a low latency, our latency increases, but we don't have any message drops. So this is something we have seen. So similar to with the CPU, that we start consuming more CPU with large volumes of data because we don't do drops, other things. The same thing happened with the latency. So this is a code example, just for you to know how it works. So our executor returns, we have a factory. We have a factory of executors. And the executors are returned as a shared pointer to the core interface. And we need to provide some information. So one of the things we need to pass is the size of the ring buffer. So, because we use a static allocation, we need to provide the size as an enum. The factory itself can be mapped to the different nodes. So different nodes may have either an event loop or a data multiplexer as a node, or multiple event loops connected to each other. It's up to you to decide, or up to the user to decide how many event loops you need for the number of cores running on the system. Like I said, the size is very important. The size of the event loop, it can be also customized via a configuration file if there are more than one, etc. But this is just a matter of tuning. We also sometimes have a test version of this, but this is a little bit beyond the scope, where you can test that the event loop is really working. So what is in the future for us? What are we working on from the research point of view? Is the multiplexer executor. It's still under testing. Although the implementation is complete, we haven't completed all the tests and the performance tests. But we know from the same experience we developed that this will be especially well suited for large volumes of data. In this case, there is only one publisher, by the way. So if you know you have more than one publisher of data, you need more than one multiplexer in this case. But the data volumes are large as well, and especially the power consumption drops a lot. This is something we have seen even more with the sensor multiplexer. So at the end, what we want to achieve with our executor is this. We want to have like a flow of executors connected. And we can use one executor or another depending on the conditions that we need to execute. So we have a LiDAR, for example. We may want to use a data multiplexer. If we have a number of smaller data producers of data, but with large volumes and we need a high throughput, for example, a loopback control, then we can put an event loop, et cetera. And this is what is in our main plans for the future. So in a nutshell, when could be interesting to use Clepsydra's executor and when is not interesting? Obviously, it's not interesting if you are producing low volumes of data, because there is an overhead with respect to the other executors. So if the number of sensors is low and the frequency at which the data is produced is low, it's not so interesting to use this type of executor like ours. When there are large volumes of producers and consumers, when there are large volumes of data, et cetera, and there are needs, especially of power and throughput, although as you could see, the latency is also good, it's more interesting to use our executor. I think that's it. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, feel free to ask.
Thanks, Pablo. So one question, you said that there will be no drops, you don't lose data. So, but this would mean if your queue is full, that you block the publisher or?
I mean, no, there is a limit. I mean, no, we saw no drops with the reference system.
Okay,
we saw no data drops in the reference system, but obviously there is a physical limit. There is a point where we start dropping. We just notify the user that the ring buffer is out of capacity, we're dropping data.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And another question, that you have this sensor multiplexer and event loop. So this are like different executor flavors. Is it always clear what I have to choose for a node, or could it also be that you cannot decide if the one or the other one is the better?
Yeah, I mean, if you're using, in the cases you are interested in using the static single threaded, you may be interested in using the event loop executor. So when you have a number of producers and number of consumers, but you want to have just one single threaded and low CPU, you use our event loop. On the other hand, if you have like this issue of the LiDAR data, have one producer of data, big data like the LiDAR, and a number of consumers, then the multiplexer is more interesting.
All right. Thanks.